Hello and welcome to the Medic's Guide. Today we're going to cover primary hyperaldosteronism, so grab your pen and paper and let's get started. So for those of you who don't remember, the adrenal glands are endocrine glands that sit on top of the kidneys. They produce a variety of hormones, including two very important ones, cortisol and aldosterone. Now primary aldosteronism, also known as primary hyperaldosteronism, refers to the excess production of the hormone aldosterone from the adrenal glands. And this is caused by two main things, either an adrenal adenoma, which we call Kahn syndrome, this accounts for 80% of all cases, or adrenal hyperplasia, and it's important to make this distinction because the treatment for both of these are slightly different. However, the symptoms and presentation is going to be the same. Although today we're focusing on primary causes, I'm going to briefly touch on secondary hyperaldosteronism. But before that, we need to truly understand what's going on, and we need to see what aldosterone even does. Now, in the kidney, in the distal convoluted tubule, there are these cells involved with electrolyte reabsorption. And there are a number of channels that help with this. So we've got a sodium channel, and we've got a sodium-potassium pump. And if you look at the arrows, you can see the direction of ion flow. Now, normally, this is regulated by aldosterone. Now, when aldosterone is in the lumen, it binds to a receptor, a mineralocorticoid receptor, which then activates the sodium channel. So some sodium goes into the cell and then gets reabsorbed. Now you can see that if aldosterone levels are high, more of these receptors will get activated, more of these channels will get activated, more sodium will go in, more sodium will get reabsorbed, and as a consequence, more potassium will go into the cell and then get excreted. And this results in hypokalemia. Now, in addition, when sodium gets reabsorbed into the capillaries, water tends to follow. And because of this, it causes high blood pressure in the individual. Now, secondary hyperaldosteronism is when the problem is causing the excess aldosterone secretion is outside of the adrenal glands. And it's usually caused by high levels of renin. Now, this is due to chronic low blood pressure. And you might see this in conditions like congestive heart failure. In terms of the symptoms, they're generally quite vague and at times may be asymptomatic. If they do have symptoms, generally they tend to be things like polyuria and polydipsia due to reduced ability of the kidney to concentrate urine, muscle weakness as a result of hyperkalemia, and that comes up in exams time and time again, and headaches and tiredness. When it comes to investigation, there's a lot of things that we can do. The first line is always to check the aldosterone and renin levels. Now in primary hyperaldosteronism, aldosterone is high and renin is low. In secondary, both are high. If we have a picture that fits primary, we could do something like a CT abdo to look for adrenal masses, and we can also do adrenal venous sampling. It's also important to check things like blood pressure, which you would expect to be quite high, and electrolyte levels. However, as I've written, in the majority of cases in real life, they are normal. A differential that you should always consider is renal artery stenosis, because it also presents with hypertension and hyperkalemia. But there is a way to identify this, and that's to do a renal arteriogram, and you should be able to identify the problem. In terms of treatment, let's start with Kahn syndrome. Surgery is a definitive treatment and involves adrenal ectomy and laparoscopic surgery. It's pretty safe and effective. One issue is that hypertension may persist after the removal of the adenoma, and that might be due to the effects of the previous hypertension on the vasculature. In terms of adrenal hyperplasia, there are a number of aldosterone antagonists that we can consider. And these are amiloride, spironolactone, and eplerenone. And this is a relatively new selective aldosterone antagonist, so it tends to have less side effects. Just to end things off, let's just cover a question. A 40-year-old woman attends for a routine appointment for a review of her blood pressure. When attending for a blood test, she was incidentally found to have a blood pressure of 160 over 80. She has completed a home blood pressure diary, which shows similar results. There is no past medical history of note, and she denies any additional symptoms. She is not currently taking any medications, and her BMI is 24. If we look at the blood results, we can see that the sodium is normal, the potassium is low, urea and creatinine are normal, and the TSH is also normal. So we've just got a low potassium hypokalemia. So if we break this question down, we've got a middle-aged woman who's got quite high blood pressure, but no other symptoms, as well as hypokalemia. So if we ever see a scenario in which we've got hypertension and hypokalemia, we should always be thinking of conditions like primary hyperaldosteronism. It could also be secondary, but aldosteronism. And as I mentioned earlier, which investigation do we always check first is the renin and aldosterone ratio. So we need to check that first. Right, that's all we're going to cover today. Thank you very much for listening. Please like, comment and subscribe. If you want me to cover any other conditions, just put a comment in down below and I can get cracking on that. Otherwise, I'll be back with another video soon.